Morning children, welcome to another interesting session of physics. We are into the unit 4th chapter of electric charges and fields. Today 5th session is going to be introduced. In the previous session you have learned about electric field due to a dipole on an axial line, on an equatorial line, and about the couple of an electric dipole. In this session, our presenter of the day, N.V. Subramaniam sir, PGT Physics, PSMS Turkapalli, Yadadri Bhonagiri district, will be introducing electric flux and Gauss law. Very important. Gauss law is the inverse of, we can say it as the complementary or the inverse of Coulomb's law of attraction. So applications of Gauss law, and Gauss law due to a straight conductor, Gauss law of a spherical surface, sir is going to deal today. I hand over the session to N.V. Subramaniam sir. Sir, welcome sir.
Madam, thank you. Respected coordinator madam, students, good morning all of you. In today's webinar series, part 5 of unit 4, let us see what are the learning objectives. The learning objectives for this particular part 5: electric flux and its calculation, Gauss law, significance of Gauss law, application of Gauss law to infinitely long straight uniformly charged wire. These are the learning objectives, and today's part 5 is a very important part of the whole webinar series for unit 4. So let us move on. Let's recall what we have learned in our earlier series. Electric field on the axial line of an electric dipole is Ea bar is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 2 p r divided by r square minus a square whole square into p cap, where r is the distance of the point, p is the electric dipole moment, and p cap is the unit vector in the direction of the dipole. Here we have seen that axial line is being considered. The same expression, when r is very much greater than a, becomes a bar is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 2 p by r cube into p cap. We have also seen that the electric field on the equatorial plane of an electric dipole is E bar is equals to minus 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 P by R square plus A square whole power 3 by 2. Into p cap, where r is again the distance of the point on the plane, equatorial plane, and p is the electric dipole moment. When r is very greater than a, then the expression can be written as E bar is equal to minus 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 p by r cube into p cap. So these were the things which were taught in the earlier webinar series. Now let us move on to the present part of the webinar series. So here I am showing you a figure in which we are having field lines. The blue colored arrows are the field lines, and we are having two closed surfaces leading. If you see here, This is one green surface, which is a closed surface, which is placed inside the uniform electric field, and another one which is kept at an angle to the electric field lines. So we have already seen in our earlier part 2 that in such a case the electric flux will change from one situation to the another situation. We know that electric flux is the number of field lines passing normal through a given closed area. So if we are seeing the figure here, the electric field lines are all parallel to each other, equidistant and unidirectional. That means we are considering a uniform electric field, and in such a uniform electric field I have placed a closed area. The green color part which we are showing is the closed area which we are considering. Now if you see here, first I am considering the area which is marked by the red arrow. See this area, children. All the field lines are able to pass through this area. The reason for that is the area itself is normal to the field lines. That means when the surface is perpendicular to the field lines, all the field lines pass through the given area. That means maximum electric flux will be passing through it. Now, if we see the second area under consideration, now again I have marked with the help of the red arrow. The green color area is now in a slanting position. That means it is making some angle with the field lines. Then what will happen? Some lines are missing the area. So the flux is definitely different from the first case. In the first case, maximum flux was passing. Now the flux is a little changed. So that makes us understand that the flux passing through a closed surface depends on the angle made by the closed surface with the field lines. Now let us see. If you are seeing on the screen, I am showing you a closed area. This is the closed area. Okay, a circular closed area, let us say. And the normal to this particular surface is n cap. It is n cap. And it is the outward normal what we have to consider. Always we have to consider the outward normal to the surface in calculation of electric flux. So area of the closed surface is A, and unit vector normal to the closed surface is n cap. Now I am showing that the uniform electric field lines are passing through the given area. The uniform electric field strength is E. Okay. So the electric flux phi is equal to E bar dot A bar. Phi is equal to E bar dot A bar, and U naught dot product, it is given by formula E A cos theta, which you learnt in first year intermediate. A bar dot B bar is always equal to A B cos. Flux phi is equal to E bar dot A bar, which will be equal to E A cos theta. So the next question what comes to my mind is, sir, when is the flux maximum? This is the question what I am getting in my mind. The answer is very simple. We know that flux is dependent on dot product. And you studied in first year intermediate that the dot product becomes maximum when theta is equal to 0 degrees. That means n cap and E bar, that means the outward normal and the electric field direction are parallel to each other, then we know that the angle becomes 0 degrees, and flux is E bar dot A bar. So flux is E A cos 0, that is E into A, since cos 0 becomes equal to 1, that means 1 into EA will become EA. So flux is equal to EA. This is the maximum flux that can pass through a given area. And you remember very clearly this situation, children. Whenever the normal, outward normal is parallel to the electric field direction. Outward normal. See here, this is the outward normal, red color arrow. Yes or not? The outward normal to the closed surface. That outward normal must be parallel to the electric field direction. Then in such a case, theta must be taken as 0 degrees. Then flux will become maximum. Flux, maximum flux is equal to E into A. Okay. So the immediately next question what comes to our mind is, sir, okay, you told when is the maximum flux? What about the zero flux case? See this case. Now the same closed surface is kept in the electric field in such a way that the normal, that is outward normal, is perpendicular to the electric field. The outward normal is perpendicular to the electric field. Then theta becomes equal to how many degrees? 90 degrees. Then automatically electric flux calculation phi is equal to E bar dot A bar is EA cos 90. Is equal to what is cos 90? Cos 90 is 0. So 0 into EA will become 0. That means absolutely no flux is passing through the given surface. The zero flux case. Please make a note of this. When is the flux 0? When the normal, outward normal, is perpendicular to the electric field direction, the electric flux through a that particular surface is 0. This case we will use in our applications of Gauss law, children. So you must make a note of both of them. This one, maximum flux case. This one, zero flux case. Both are very, very important from the application point of view. And even while solving problems involving calculation of electric flux. So let us move on. So again I am showing you the case where the normal is parallel to the electric field. In such a case, electric flux is E bar dot A bar, EA cos 0. Cos 0 is plus 1. So the electric flux is plus EA. What is the electric flux? Plus EA. Then in such a scenario, outward flux will be taken as positive. So this is important, children. The flux coming out of the surface, the flux this part, the flux which is coming out of the surface, that outward flux is taken as positive. What is it taken as? Positive. So this convention you must remember. The outward flux will be taken as positive. Now let us see the next case. So now if you see, I have reversed the direction of electric field. Okay, so that the field lines are coming into the surface. But this is the outward normal to the surface. Then what happens? Electric field direction and outward normal are oppositely directed, then theta must be taken as 180 degrees. That means in this particular case, the field lines are passing into the surface. So electric flux phi is equal to E bar dot A bar, EA cos 180 degrees. Whereas in earlier case, we took 0 degrees. Now we have to take 180 degrees. What is cos 180? Minus 1. So minus 1 into EA will become minus EA. So the flux is phi is equal to minus EA. That means inward flux will be taken as negative. So these two points are very important. Outward flux taken as positive. Inward flux taken as negative. Both are important cases which will be useful to us throughout the application of Gauss law as well as calculation of electric flux for given situation. I hope you followed. Let us move on. So the doubt coming in our mind is, again the thinking man has appeared here. What is this, the doubt in his mind? Let us calculate the electric flux of a non-uniform electric field. That is a question. That is a question what is coming up in his mind. What do you mean by non-uniform electric field? A uniform electric field, the field is same everywhere, both in magnitude and direction. In a non-uniform electric field, the electric field is different in different points, both in magnitude as well as direction. So it may have a particular magnitude in one point, a particular magnitude in another point. So if magnitude and direction both are same only, we tell it is uniform. If they are not same at every point, that is called as non-uniform electric field. In such a case, what is the method to be followed for calculating the electric flux through a given area? This is the case what we are asking. Let us see what is the method we have to adopt. Okay, systematically let us adopt the method and try to arrive the answer. The first step, we divide the total closed area into many small elements of area dA each. Then each of the small areas as a perpendicular, the vector area of each such element is given as dA bar is equal to dA into n cap. Then the electric flux through each small element d phi is equal to E bar into E bar dot dA bar. Now let me explain one by one again all the points. The first point tells us that any closed area what we are taking, in this case we divide into many small elements each of area dA each. You divide the total closed area into small parts. Okay, each area you take as dA. Okay, then for each area we have to consider the outward normal vector n cap perpendicular to it. Each of the small areas has a unit vector n perpendicular to it. Then the vector area of such an element is given by dA bar is equal to dA into the area vector of that small element as dA bar. dA bar denotes the area of the small element what we have taken, and dA bar will be dA into n cap. Okay, then the flux through that small element is given by d phi is equal to E bar dot dA bar. In the uniform field we had E bar dot A bar. Now since the field is non-uniform, therefore we are taking d phi is equal to E bar dot dA bar, where E bar is the electric field at that particular small element under consideration. Let us continue. Now the electric flux through each small element is d phi is equal to E bar dot dA bar. Then electric flux phi through the entire closed surface is phi is equal to integral d phi, or phi is equal to integral E bar dot dA bar, or E dA cos theta. So let us now again see what are the important points here. We have already seen that d phi is E bar dot dA bar. Now once you know d phi for a small element, then how to calculate the value of the total flux? This d phi gives the electric flux for only one small element. It is giving the electric flux for one small area of the closed, total closed area. Yes or not? For one part flux is d phi, but I want the total flux for all the entire closed area. Then in such a case, The electric flux through the entire closed surface is then given by phi is equal to integral d phi. So here you all studied already in first year intermediate, integral dx is equal to x. Yes or not? So I adopted the same method. Integral d phi is equal to phi. So phi becomes integral d phi, or in case of d phi, we have to substitute e bar dot da bar. I am substituting e bar dot da bar, and dot product of e bar and da bar will become eda cos theta. Eda cos theta, where theta is the angle between the two vectors e bar and da bar. Okay, this is the method used to find out the electric flux in case of a non-uniform electric field for the entire area. This is what we have to do. So we can arrive at the answer for electric flux by integrating the flux value for a small area. So let us see continuation. So to make this process more understandable to you, I have considered a very small example for all of you. So what is this example? Electric flux through a sphere. This is what I am considering for you. So whatever points I discussed earlier, steps, I mean the steps what I have discussed to calculate the total flux, those steps now I am going to use one by one and arrive at the value of the total flux. First, let us try to understand what is there in the figure on the screen. If you see this blue color, you are able to see this blue color sphere. This blue color sphere is the charged body. Let us say it is a charged body, and the charge on that body is plus Q. What is the charge on the body? Plus Q. So now what am I trying to do? Around this charged body, this blue color body is there, no? Around this charged body, I am constructing a sphere. Sphere means closed surface or open surface? Yes, your doubt is right. It's a closed surface. So now this closed surface has radius how much? R. Now my question is, how to calculate the flux through this closed surface? That is the question. This is a non-uniform field, children. Reason is simple. If I take, for example, electric field at this point, then it will be in this direction, white arrow. If I take electric field at this point, then it will be outwards like this again, outward arrow. If I take electric field at this point, it will be like this, outward arrow. That means at each and every point, field direction is changing on the sphere. That means that it is a non-uniform electric field. This is the case what we have explained earlier, all those steps. So in such a particular scenario, what are the methods I have to adopt to get the total electric flux? For that, I am dividing. Here if you see this small red color area you are seeing, that is the small area what I have considered on the sphere. On the sphere. Okay, on the sphere. What is the distance of this point from that particular, or this element from the center? It is equal to radius. Because it is on the surface, the distance has to be equal to the radius. Now let the electric field through this small element is E bar. And let the area of this small element is dA. So once again, the figure you see carefully, in the figure if you see carefully, we are having one charged body plus Q. Around that charged body, I have taken a closed sphere and I am trying to calculate the flux through the sphere. The radius of this sphere is R, and I have imagined that there is a small element of area dA on the surface of the sphere. Electric field through that element is E bar, and This is the outward normal. Red color arrow you are seeing, all of you. That red color arrow is the outward normal. And the outward normal is the direction of the area vector dA bar. So first step I have finished. In the earlier whatever steps I have listed, I have finished the first step. What is the first step? Consider that the total space is divided into small, small areas, each of element, each of area dA. Let us see the next step. The electric flux through the small element considered is d phi is equal to E bar dot dA bar or E dA cos theta or d phi is equal to E dA cos 0 or d phi is equal to E into dA because cos 0 is equal to 1. Let us call this as equation number 1. Then the electric flux through the entire closed surface is then given by phi is equal to integral d phi or phi is equal to integral E into dA. So I hope the steps are clear to all of you. What is the first step? The first E bar dot dA bar is E dA cos theta. Here theta, cos theta. Theta is the angle between E and dA. And if you see in the earlier diagram, you see the diagram which we have shown, E is, this is the white arrow, dA is the red arrow. Both are in the same direction. That means they are having an angle of 0 degrees between them. Okay. So, I am coming back to the equations part. Here, theta is 0, cos 0. Cos 0 equals to 1. So, 1 into EDA becomes EDA. So, d phi is EDA. Let that be called as 1. Equation number 1. Then the electric flux phi through the entire closed surface is then given by, what is the next step I told you? So, in the steps we have listed, we have seen that the next step is calculating the electric flux through small element. I have calculated the flux through small element. D phi is EDA. Now what did I do? I have to calculate the electric flux through the entire area, that is entire sphere. So how to calculate? Let the entire flux is phi. Then phi will be integral D phi. Or phi is equal to E into dA. Now let us see what is the next step. So, phi is integral d phi or E bar dot dA, E dA. This is the important step, children. So, what does this tell? E has same magnitude everywhere at distance r from the charge q. So, on the sphere, in the starting also I was telling, on the sphere, all the points are at same distance from the center. What does that mean? Electric field is going to be same for all the points on the sphere due to the charge. That means magnitude is going to be same. Magnitude is going to be same. Direction is different, no doubt. But magnitude is going to be same. That means E has same magnitude everywhere at distance r from the charge q. So E is a constant. Since it is a constant, I have to write it outside the integration. That means in this step, phi is equal to E bar dot dA bar. I can write E outside and integral dA. Already cos 0 we have seen 1. So, as integral dA is equal to A, we know integral dx is what? X. So, integral dA has to be equal to what? A. So, the expression becomes phi is equal to E into A. Let us call that as equation number 2. Now, let's continue. Phi is equal to EA. That is equation number 2. And the area of the sphere, we all know, A is 4 pi r square. So, phi is equal to E into 4 pi r square. Let that be equation number 3. Okay, here I have substituted A is 4 pi r square, which is the total area of the sphere. That means I get phi is equal to E into 4 pi r square. Substituting the value of electric field for a charge Q. What is the formula? We all learnt number of times. E is 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 Q by R square at distance R. So I am substituting that in the equation number 3. What am I getting? See here. E value. I am substituting 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 Q by R square. I substituted here, you see. 1 by 4 pi epsilon 0 Q by R square into 4 pi R square. Now can you simplify this equation 3, children? Very simple, very simple. Yes. 4 pi cancel. Numerator, denominator. Then 1 R square cancel. What are we left with? Let us see. Yes, right. In the equation 3, 4 pi cancelled. R square cancelled. I am left with 1 by epsilon 0 in the bracket and Q outside the bracket. Okay. 1 by epsilon 0 inside the bracket and Q outside the bracket. So, pi is equal to 1 by epsilon 0 into Q. This Q is the charge inside the sphere. So, I wrote it as Q in. Q in. In meaning inside. This is how standard books give the expression. In. In meaning inside. The charge inside the closed surface. So, the electric flux phi is always equal to 1 by epsilon 0 Q inside or enclosed charge. This is also known as what? Enclosed charge. This is the expression what we were waiting for. This is actually Gauss law. So, we have actually arrived at Gauss law. So, what is Gauss law? Let us learn. The electric flux phi through a closed surface is 1 by epsilon 0 times the net charge Q in enclosed within the surface. So net charge Q in, net charge. Here I am using the word net charge. So this is an important word. Net charge actually means, if let us say there are two charges, three charges, four charges like that inside that particular sphere, then the flux is due to the all the charges which are inside that sphere. That means net charge is sum of all the charges inside the closed surface, that is enclosed within the surface. So this is put in the form of a expression. Phi is equal to 1 by epsilon 0 into Q in, where Q in denotes the charge enclosed within the surface. Enclosed meaning inside. Enclosed always means inside, inside the surface. I hope you followed Gauss law. Let us now try to understand some importance attached to the Gauss law or significance attached to the Gauss law. So, significance of Gauss law. What's the first point? The Gauss law is true for any closed surface. The term Q in Gauss law is the sum of all the charges enclosed by the surface. Now, let us try to understand one by one. First point, what does it tell? Gauss law is true for any closed surface. What does this mean? In Gauss law statement, did you see that it is only true for sphere or some other closed surface or like a box or something like that? No. Gauss law in general is applicable for any shape of closed surface, any size of closed surface. So there is no restriction on size or shape. Whenever we are considering a closed surface, we need not worry about whether it is some particular shape or not. It has to be closed. That is the only condition they are keeping on that law. It can be of any size. It can be of any shape. Arbitrary shape can be taken. Arbitrary. What do you mean by arbitrary? Any shape. Okay. Then, the term Q in Gauss law is the sum of all the charges enclosed by the surface. This I want to again emphasize. Earlier also I was emphasizing. What does this mean? For example, in the earlier sphere example, let us say inside the sphere there are three charges or four charges, let us say. One is 8 coulombs, one is 6 coulombs, one is 5 coulombs, and another one is minus 5 coulombs. Then what is the total charge? 8 plus 6, 14 plus 5, 19, and there is minus 5. 19 minus 5 becomes 14. That means the total charge inside the surface should be considered. Q inside is the sum of all the charges present inside the closed surface, enclosed within the surface. Okay, now let us see the next point. The term Q in Gauss law is the sum of all the charges enclosed by the surface, but the electric field appearing in Gauss law is the resultant electric field due to all charges present inside as well as outside the given closed surface. So this is a very, very, very important point, children. When we are applying Gauss law, we wrote phi is E bar dot A bar, E bar dot dA bar. Yes or not? There E bar, electric field. That electric field, whatever is appearing in the Gauss law, that can be both due to the inside charges as well as outside charges. But Q in should be only due to the charges present inside the surface. This is a very crucial point. So while dealing with Gauss law, this condition has to be borne in the mind by all the students. The field is both due to inside as well as outside charges, whereas the flux is only due to the charges which are present inside. Okay, let us continue. The fourth significance: a surface on which Gauss law is being applied is called Gaussian surface. Next one: when the system has some symmetry, Gauss law helps us in much easier calculation of the electric field. Next, Gauss law is based on inverse square dependence on distance contained in Coulomb's law. So here the fourth point, what does it tell? A surface on which Gauss law is being applied is called Gaussian surface. We have seen in the example, sphere example, that sphere is a closed surface, no? That is where we started, yes or not? That sphere itself can be considered as Gaussian surface. So whatever closed surface we are considering, that closed surface itself is known as Gaussian surface. Okay, next, when the system has some symmetry, Gauss law helps in much easier calculation of the electric field. This symmetry condition, whatever we are telling here, when the system has some symmetry, Gauss law helps in easier calculation of electric field. This I will explain in the coming up example of line charge. Okay, then the sixth one, Gauss law is based on inverse square dependence on distance contained in Coulomb's law. What did you learn in Coulomb's law, children? The force is inversely proportional to square of the distance between the two charges. So Gauss law is based on that fact. That is what is the meaning of the sixth point. Okay, so let us move on. As now come to the application of Gauss law. So for some symmetric charge configurations, it is possible to obtain the electric field in a simple way using the Gauss's law. So in the concluding part of this particular unit 4, we are having applications of Gauss law, and we are dealing with some configurations where we are able to apply Gauss law and get the answer for the electric field of that particular charge distribution. So what is the importance of Gauss law means? Whenever there is a continuous charge distribution, not a point charge. I'm talking about continuous charge distribution. Then it becomes more easier to calculate the electric field using Gauss law. As an example, let us see what is the meaning of a continuous charge distribution I'm talking. So now I am trying to apply Gauss law for calculating electric field due to infinitely long straight uniformly charged wire. So I am trying to calculate electric field due to infinitely long straight uniformly charged wire. See here, all of you see here, this is a uniformly charged wire and it is positively charged. It is infinitely long, so that is the reason I am showing it by dots. You see here, I am showing dots. These dots symbolize that they are infinitely long wire and it is uniformly charged. For this example, I have taken positive charge, okay, and the linear charge density of this wire, which is also known as charge per unit length, is lambda. So the word linear charge density means charge per unit length. That means charge divided by length. Again, I repeat, charge divided by length. If the charge is Q and if the length is L, charge is Q and length is L, then Q by L is the value of lambda. I repeat, please remember all of you, it is very important. Q by L is the value of lambda. Okay, so this wire has a linear charge density of lambda. Okay, and I am trying to calculate the electric field at distance r from the wire, perpendicular distance how much? R. So there is a point P in the space. At distance r from the wire, I am trying to calculate the electric field due to this particular wire. So this wire will definitely create electric field around itself. You may get a doubt, sir, you are talking about only this side. Can I take the point that side? Yes, you can take. Nothing wrong. Absolutely nothing wrong. Wherever you want, you take the point. You can calculate the electric field by using proper methodology. Let us see how to calculate the electric field at that particular point. For calculating the electric field, I have taken a Gaussian surface around the wire. What is the shape of this Gaussian surface? Cylindrical Gaussian surface. Okay, what is the shape? Cylindrical Gaussian surface. And this cylindrical Gaussian surface has length L and radius R. That means I am enclosing the point which is under consideration. Okay. Now if you see carefully, the electric field of this wire is outward normal at each and every place on this particular Gaussian surface, on the Gaussian surface. See here, outward normal. The red lines are electric field direction. And why are they going out? Why are they going out or away from the wire? Field of positive charge, is it towards the wire or away from the wire? It is away from the wire. That means all the field lines are, this side they will be going in this direction, this side they will be going in this direction. Okay. So, at every point on the cylindrical part of the Gaussian surface, the electric field must be having same magnitude, and for a positively charged configuration must be directed radially outwards. So what does this mean? on the curved part of the cylinder. At every point, the field is having same magnitude because the distance is same from, let us say, from top of the cylindrical part to the bottom of the cylindrical part, from here to here. If I take these two edges, one edge here, at all the points, distance is same. That means magnitude is same. That is the meaning of this. And it is radially outwards. That means it is pointing out away from the wire. Even here also, it is pointing away from the wire. So E value is going to be same at all the points for the Gaussian surface, that is cylindrical surface, that is curved part. This curved part around the wire you are seeing, cylindrical curved part. For that part, at every point, electric field is going to be same magnitude. That is the meaning of this. Okay. Now, if you see carefully, the electric field is pointing in this direction. Again, we are showing to you for that point P. And if you see the surface carefully, the Gaussian surface is a cylindrical surface, no? So this cylindrical surface has this upper part, then this curved part surrounding the wire, and this lower part. So if you see carefully, there are three closed surfaces under consideration. One, the top part, surface number one. Two, the curved part, like this, the curved part around the wire, okay, the cylindrical part which is curved, okay, that is the surface number three. And surface number two is the bottom closed part of the cylinder. So totally how many surfaces I have considered? Three. And that makes it a closed surface. And when it is a closed surface only, then I can apply Gauss law. And by using Gauss law, I can calculate the value of the electric field for that particular point. That is my idea. See, there is a meaning for everything, whatever we are doing. When I considered the cylinder around that particular wire, why did I take a cylinder? Because it is enclosing the charge and it is a closed surface. That is the reason for choosing a cylindrical part, because the cylinder totally encloses the charged area. Okay. And it is a closed surface. So now let us move on. So now I calculate the flux for each and every surface individually, one by one. First, I am considering the surface number one. For your easy understanding, I am giving you the surface number one here. And we have already seen that electric field is pointing in this direction. Yes or not? So for surface number one, if I take outward normal, we have to take outward normal. No, number of times I told you, area should be always outward normal. That means dA bar will be outward normal area, outwardly normal. That means going out of the way. Now dA bar will be in the direction of the yellow arrow. Electric field is already given by the red arrow. What is the angle between both of them? 90 degrees. What is the angle? 90 degrees. That means both are perpendicular. You see, all of you, both are perpendicular. When both are perpendicular, what is the meaning of that? Angle is 90 degrees. That means phi is equal to e bar dot dA bar, or integral e bar dot dA bar, or integral e dA cos 90. So I am applying your Gauss law here. Phi is integral e bar dot dA bar. E bar dot dA bar becomes e dA cos 90 dot product. Angle how much I have taken? 90 degrees. What is cos 90? 0. So 0 into e dA will become 0. That means the flux through the first surface is 0. There is no flux through the first surface at all. In fact, if you remember this diagram, I told you in the first 10 minutes of this webinar class, I told you, yes or not, whenever the normal to the surface is perpendicular to the electric field, flux becomes zero. There is no flux through the surface. This is the same situation. So you would have guessed it already, because it has already been covered in the first 10 minutes itself. So the flux through this surface one is zero. Now, similarly take the surface number three. Again, similar type of area. This is top area, this is bottom. Again, outward normal I am taking, yellow arrow. Again, electric field. Our electric field is like this, in the red arrow direction. Our area is in this direction, outward normal. What is the angle between them? 90 degrees. That means again, the value becomes phi is equal to e bar dot dA bar, or phi is integral e bar dot dA bar, or integral eda cos 90. Cos 90 value 0. That means 0 into eda will become 0. So what is the meaning of this? Flux through the third surface is also 0. So our three surface, we have divided the total Gaussian surface. Here we have considered as three surfaces. Yes or not? In that 1 and 3, 0 flux. Now what about the second surface? Let us see. So surface 2 under consideration. Let us see. The curved part. The curved part. Okay? The curved part. If you take the curved part, the electric field is outwards. And normal to the curved part is dA. At any point, let us say, at any point on the curved part, normal is dA, that is area vector is dA bar. And it is outwardly normal, as usual, as we have been telling again and again, it is outwardly normal. So, when it is outwardly normal, the electric field and dA bar will point in the same direction. So, angle must be 0 degrees. That means the flux through the curved part can be now given as per our Gauss law derivation or Gauss law, phi is equal to e bar dot dA bar is equal to eda cos 0. So the flux through the entire curved part will be phi is equal to integral dA bar, e bar dot dA bar or eda cos 0. Cos 0 value how much? 1. So 1 into eda will become eda, and since e is same everywhere, e has same magnitude, yes or not, everywhere on that curved part, yes or not? That's what I told you, e has same magnitude everywhere on the curved part, so it is a constant in magnitude, so e right outside, then I will be left with integral dA. So first step, if you see, phi is integral e bar dot dA bar, e into dA into cos 0 1, e into dA, e is a constant in magnitude right outside. So phi is e into integral dA. Next step, integral dA is what? A. So the area of that cylindrical part, area of the cylindrical part, whatever we have considered, that is, you know how to calculate area already in your school level. Area of the cylinder is given by formula A is equal to 2 pi r into L, where L is the length under consideration. Okay, then A is equal to 2 pi r L. So I substitute this back in the equation number 1. I am getting phi is equal to E into 2 pi r L. Let that be called as equation number. Now, we have seen phi is e into integral dA, equation 1. Integral dA is A is 2 pi RL, or e or phi is equal to e into 2 pi RL, that is equation number 2. From Gauss law, phi is equal to 1 by epsilon 0 times q inside, that is equation number 3. So, what is q in? That is lambda L. Why, children? Why it is lambda L, tell me? In the starting, what did I tell? Lambda denotes the charge density, linear charge density. How do you calculate linear charge density? Charge by length. So what is the charge enclosed in that Gaussian surface? That is Q in. Enclosed means inside, no. So lambda is Q in divided by L. Or if you cross multiply, Q in is equal to lambda into L. Continuing, E is, that is already phi is E into 2 pi RL, which is the equation number 2. And phi is 1 by epsilon 0 Q in. Q in is lambda L. Then, since Q in is lambda L, if I substitute Q in lambda L, I will get phi is equal to 1 by epsilon 0 times lambda L, which is the equation number 4. So now if you see equation 2 and equation 4, both are flux only. Phi is E into 2 pi RL, here flux is 1 by epsilon 0 lambda L. That means left hand sides are equal, right hand sides also must be equal. So from equations 2 and 4, since LHS are equal, I am equating RHS, E into 2 pi RL is equal to 1 by epsilon 0 times lambda L. From equations 2 and 4, E into 2 pi RL is 1 by epsilon 0 lambda L. In the left side L and in the right side L cancel. Then L and L cancel. If I L and L cancel, what are we left with? E is equal to, this 2 pi comes to the denominator. Already here 1 by epsilon 0 is there. That means 1 by 2 pi epsilon 0 lambda divided by, this R also comes to the denominator, lambda by R. This is the final expression for electric field due to an infinitely long straight charged wire at distance r from the wire, perpendicular distance r from the wire, E is 1 by 2 pi epsilon 0 lambda by r. I hope you followed. That brings us to the concluding part of this particular session. Let us see what have we learned. Electric flux phi is equal to E bar dot A bar is EA cos theta. Gauss law. The electric flux phi through a closed surface is 1 by epsilon 0 times the net charge Q in enclosed within the surface. And in the expression form, Gauss law is given as phi is 1 by epsilon 0 times Q in. And in the last part of this session, we have seen that the electric field due to an infinitely long, straight, uniformly charged wire is E is 1 by 2 pi epsilon 0 lambda R. To test your understanding, here are a few questions. The first one, state Gauss law in electrostatics. Second one, write the expression for electric field, that is electric intensity due to a infinitely long, straight, uniformly charged wire at a radial distance r from the wire. And the last one, an infinitely long charge. An infinitely line charge produces a field of 9 into 10 power 4 newton per coulomb at a distance of 2 centimeters. calculate the linear charge density of that wire. Thank you for giving this opportunity. If you have any doubts, please put it into the chat box, which will be addressed in the next webinar series. Thank you. I thank my coordinator, madam, for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Subramaniam, sir. Children, you might have gained a clear understanding about what is Gauss law, what is linear charge density, what is surface charge density, what is volume charge density, and what are the applications of Gauss law. So it's a very important lesson in electrostatics, Gauss law. Please, if you find any difficulty, at the end, in the test, your understanding, sir has given a problem, you solve it and put it in the comment section. And if you have any doubt, you can post your queries in the comment section, sir will be ready to answer them. Sir, thank you for the detailed explanation about Gauss law. Thank you very much.
Okay.